Monte Ellis has been a great player and had several seasons where he averaged well over 20 points a game and was worthy of being an All-Star. But shockingly, he never has been, making him one of the top players to never be an All-Star. He's been known for creating flashy and highlight plays, but also for holding onto the ball too long at times. Monte's most All-Star worthy season was back in 2009 and 10, where he averaged over 25 points, 4 rebounds, and 5 assists per game. He had better stats than most of the players in the 2010 All-Star game, but his team was in the bottom 5 worst teams in the NBA that year, with a record of 26-56. On his team, he only had the help of Corey Maggette, a young Steph Curry, Steven Jackson for only 30 games, and Anthony Tolliver was their only big man to score over 10 points a game with 12, but he only played 44 games anyways. So it's safe to say that it wasn't all Monte's fault that the Warriors had such a bad record. But I mean, does your team's record really reflect if you make the All-Star team or not? Look at Anthony Davis. And yes, Anthony Davis is a much better player than Monte Ellis was, but he still has a losing record. Now getting into the actual All-Star game, Steve Nash was voted in by the fans at the point guard position, and of course Kobe Bryant was the lead vote getter in the West with 2.4 million votes. So let's just say that it's fair that Monte wasn't going to be named a starter. But there was going to be 3 guards, 3 forwards, and 1 center coming off the bench in the All-Star game. The original 3 guards selected were Chris Paul, Brandon Roy, and Deron Williams. And before we get into comparing stats, it's important to note that up until the 2010 All-Star break, some statistics had shown that the Warriors played better when Monte was off the court at times. And also, Monte was among the league leaders in minutes played, shots per game, steals, and turnovers. But if we take a look at Brandon Roy, Deron Williams, and Chris Paul's stats compared to Monte's, side note, we're going to be looking at season averages instead of averages up until the All-Star game, because it might be a little inaccurate, but it's much easier. But if we look at those 3 players, we can see that Monte Ellis averaged 25.5 points per game, 4 rebounds, 5 assists, 3.8 turnovers, and led his team to 26 wins and 56 losses. Chris Paul averaged 22 points per game, a league-high 2.8 steals, and also a league-high 11 assists per game, with 2.5 turnovers, leading his team to 37 wins and 45 losses. Brandon Roy averaged 21 points, 4 assists, 4 rebounds a game, and 2 turnovers, helping his team to a 50 win and 32 loss season. And Deron Williams averaged just 18 points, 10 assists, and 4 rebounds per game, with 3.3 turnovers, and giving his team a 53 win and 29 loss season. So I mean, if you're looking at just stats, Chris Paul deserves his spot, of course, and due to the fact that he was the best point guard in the league, but Monte should have made it over Brandon Roy and Deron Williams. But if you're looking at record and the leadership effect that these players showed on their teams, you can see how the NBA and the coaches might have made this decision. But that doesn't matter, because Chris Paul and Brandon Roy would both get injured, along with starter Kobe Bryant. So Chauncey Billups replaced Chris Paul, Chris Kaman replaced Brandon Roy, and Jason Kidd replaced Kobe Bryant. So let's take a look at their seasons. Chauncey Billups averaged 19 points per game, 3 rebounds, and 6 assists, with 2.1 turnovers a game, helping his team to a 53 win and 29 loss record. But Carmelo Anthony was the best player on the team that year. Chris Kaman averaged 18 points, 9 rebounds, and 1 assist per game, who was the leader of a team that went 29-53. Jason Kidd averaged only 10 points per game, 9 assists, and 5 rebounds, helping his team to 55 wins and 27 losses. But he also played with Dirk Nowitzki, who averaged 25 points a game that season. So again, if you're looking at numbers, the replacement spot of Chris Paul should have definitely went to Monte Ellis instead of Chauncey. Although there's a chance not too many teammates would get the ball if Monte had it at point guard. But if you're looking at qualities in these players that led their team to wins, you could make a case for Billups too. In Chris Kaman's case for stats, Monte should have made it for sure, especially because they were both on bad teams with similar records. But it's acceptable for Chris Kaman to have gotten that spot, due to the fact that Pau Gasol was the only other reserve center for the West All-Stars. As for Jason Kidd, he really shouldn't have been picked over Monte Ellis. He was one of the league's best and most respected players, but you can't argue about him having a better record, because like I said, Dirk Nowitzki was averaging 25 that year. But in Kidd's defense, I could see the NBA wanting a big name player in Kobe Bryant's starting spot to be more recognizable. But they just as easily could have slid Billups into that spot, who was a former NBA champion and finals MVP, then put Monte as a reserve instead of Jason Kidd. I guess the NBA was really into team leaders this year. So Monte didn't make the All-Star game, even though he was the 6th leading scorer in points for the 2009 and 10 season. But his team was 26-56, and the next closest team that produced West All-Stars that year were Chris Kaman and the Clippers at 29-53, who has an exception because they needed a big man, and after that was the Hornets and Chris Paul at a 37-46 record. Besides them, most every other team in the West had pretty good records for the 2009 and 10 season. But now that I've given both sides the argument, make sure to comment and give your stance on how All-Stars should be determined and if it should be chosen by stats, record, or a combination of both. Also, make sure to comment if you think Monte Ellis deserved a spot in the 2010 NBA All-Star Game. There's good arguments for both sides, so let me know, and thanks to everyone for watching.